Hello everyone. This Dr. Vinodan sir is kindly completed his UG from Tirunelveli Medical College and he completed his diploma from Madurai Medical College and kindly studying his continuing his MS ENT in Kilpak Medical College. Now he is going to take topic on audiology and vestibular physiology. So kindly utilize his classes and kindly gain knowledge. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for this wonderful intro, Dr. Kavindraj. So, good evening, everyone. Hope you have everyone have went through this anatomy of external, middle, and inner ear, so that you could remember something from the for every other things we study or we are going to see in the topic of ear. The anatomy of ear will help you a lot. So if you didn't study it after the classes, kindly go and read it today. Okay, so before starting to audiology and vestibular physiology, I have already on the last day how the sound is conducted from the external ear to the middle ear and into the inner ear, the process of transduction and everything. I told you how the external acoustic meatus receives the sound in the form of air, that is the sound touches the tympanic membrane, transmits into the ossicles, into the vowel window. The foot plate of Sapis, which rests on the vowel window, and it from there the fluids in the inner ear are getting stimulated and we hear the sound, right? So this is the basic thing for our hearing. Of course, the vestibular physiology. So since we were seeing about the conduction of sound and transduction in the last class, I think it will be very easy if we continue with the audiology now. So the assessment of hearing. In the assessment of hearing, first we are going to see about the tuning fork test. Okay, so this is the tuning fork. I hope you have seen it in your first year physiology practicals. The most common frequency we use in ENT is 512 hertz. Okay. In medicine, we use 256 hertz. Why? Because this is best felt. In medicine, we use tuning fork for vibration sense to check that. Okay, but in ENT, coming to ENT, we will be using 512 hertz because it is best heard than best felt. Okay, for ear, we should hear well. That's why. And also, this 512 hertz falls in the range of the speech frequencies. So the speech frequencies, in the speech frequencies, the tuning forks, the frequencies are 512, 1024 and 2000 hertz. So we are taking this 512 hertz to assess the hearing for all the tuning fork tests. Okay, so as I told on that day, the ear has, the sound has to reach three pathways finally before we hear. So that is the conductive, sensory, and neural pathway. I hope you remember. Conductive means the external ear and middle ear coming into play till the foot plate of Sapis. Okay. Sensory is in the cochlea. And neural is also called as retrocochlear. That is from the cochlear nerves into the brain. So we are going to check all these three pathways using the tuning fork test. Okay, so the ear is sensitive. I hope you everyone remember that ear is sensitive to sounds ranging from 20 to 20,000 hertz. That is the range to which our ear is sensitive. Okay, and in the tuning floor test, what we are going to, how we are going to check this? Air conduction and bone conduction. Okay, so air conduction means the entire auditory pathway. That is from we will keep the tuning fork in front of the ear, so that when after we strike the tuning fork in any or bony prominence, the ringing sensation will be heard through the external acoustic meters, and it will go through all this pathway. So we are going to see through the air conduction, we will see the conductive plus the cochlea, the sensory and the neural all. So everything we will be seeing in that. So air conduction will include all the three pathways, conductive plus sensory. Bone conduction, what will happen in bone conduction? We will keep the tuning fork in the mastoid tip, that is behind the ear. So in the when we are keeping the tuning fork there, what happens is we are bypassing this pathway. So this won't come into action. So what is the when the tuning fork is kept in the skull vibrates. Okay, so in the bony cochlea, the skull vibrates, and the transmission, the vibration will get transferred to the bony cochlea through that, through the fluid, then the other pathway comes. So we are bypassing the conductive pathway, so we are checking only the sensory and neural pathway through bone conduction. So since we are checking all the three pathways in air conduction is always better than bone conduction. Okay. Air conduction is always greater than bone conduction because we are checking all the three pathways in air conduction. So now coming to Raine's test. So Raine's test is nothing. I hope you would have done in the first year physiology practicals, and even maybe in the medicine of to check the vestibular cochlea now. Okay, so here the tuning fork is kept outside the ear. So that is first we are checking the air conduction. Okay, air conduction. So in the normal ear, as I already told, the air conduction should be always greater than bone conduction. So what if the air conduction is lesser? Okay, so if the Raine's test is, this is called as positive Raine. If the air conduction is lesser than bone conduction, so what we'll be doing is we will be asking the patient to say when the conduction, when he stops hearing the sound, when the tuning fork has been placed in front of the ear. So first you will be placing the tuning fork like this. First you will be placing the tuning fork out lateral to his external acoustic meters. So we'll ask the patient to listen to the sound, and he should say once the sound stops, and then we'll keep the tuning fork in the mastoid. Okay, so normally he should not hear when the tuning fork is kept in the mastoid, because air conduction is greater than bone conduction. But if the patient says I'm able to hear the bone conduction even after the sound stops when you keep outside the ear, so there is some abnormality. Okay, so normally it is if the air conduction is lesser than bone conduction, it is called Raine's negative, and this is usually seen in conductive hearing loss. Okay, see why conductive hearing loss? Because if the Raine's is positive, we are checking all the three pathways, conductive plus sensory plus neural, so it is normal. Or there is also another possibility, sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, so sensory neural hearing loss means that is the cochlea, the defect is in the cochlea or the nerve. Why there is sensory neural hearing loss? But you can hear because we cannot differentiate whether it is coming from the right ear or left ear. Okay, so when the tuning fork is placed, he can also hear that through the other ear in which the tuning fork is not placed. Okay, so the other ear also comes into action. So I already told that superior olivary complex that will help in localization of sound, and in normal time there will be some reduction in sound. If you are keeping the tuning fork in the right ear, he can hear through the left ear, but little bit the decibel will be low. The right ear will hear the sound louder. Okay, so if in the right side, if it is a positive range, means it may be a normal ear or it might be a sensorineural hearing loss. Since the left ear also comes into action, he can hear well. Okay, but if the ear conduction is less than bone conduction, that is, if the rhenis is negative, it could be conductive hearing loss. Okay, or severe sensorineural hearing loss. So the rhenis test is very important. So what is the inference? What are we going to differentiate is through the rhenis, we should know whether it is normal ear or conductive hearing loss or a sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, severe sensory neural loss or sudden severe sensory neural hearing loss will also manifest as negative rhenis. Okay, so positive rhenis means ear conduction is greater than bone conduction, so it is will be normal ear or sensorineural hearing loss. Negative rhenis means bone conduction is better than ear conduction, so it is in conductive hearing loss. It will be seen in conductive hearing loss or severe sensorineural hearing loss. So okay, so through rhenis test we have come to know little idea about whether it is normal or sensorineural hearing loss or conductive hearing loss. So to know which ear is that, okay, we will now go to Weber's test. Through Weber's test, what we are coming to know is the sound will lateralize to ears, either right or left. So we can come to know which ear is defective. Okay. So in the Weber's test, what we'll be doing is we'll keep the tuning fork. We will shake the tuning fork in the bony prominence, and we'll be keeping in the vertex or in the forehead or in the upper teeth. Okay, so mostly but commonly we are keeping in the vertex of the head, so that the vibration will lateralize to either any one of the ear. Okay, so that is Weber's test. So the inference is what in it, there is a mnemonic called SOX. Okay, so in sensorineural hearing loss, it will get lateralized to opposite ear. In conductive hearing loss, it will get lateralized to same ear. So same ear means the diseased ear. If he has a pathology in right ear, say for example he has chronic suppurative otitis media in right ear, the Weber's will get lateralized to the same ear, to the right ear. Okay. If he has sensorineural deafness in right ear, the Weber's will get lateralized to left ear. Okay, so why this is lateralized to same ear in conductive hearing loss? Because the external sound does not interfere. Okay, when we strike the tuning fork and we keep on the mastoid, he will be having either a wax. Okay, even a wax is also some blockage in the external auditory pathway. So that is also a conductive hearing loss or any peripheral. So any conductive neural hearing loss, why the sound is lateralized to same ear? Because the external sound does not interfere and only the bone conduction will get carried. Okay, so this is lateralized to the same ear in conductive hearing loss. In Weber's, it is lateralized to opposite ear. So remember the mnemonic SOX. Okay, that will help. The next tuning fork test is absolute bone conduction. So absolute bone conduction is it is nothing but the same test, but we won't test rhenis. We will keep the tuning fork in the mastoid, but we will check it with the examiner. Okay, provided the examiner's Hearing should be normal. And we are comparing with that. Okay. So what we are in obsolete bone condition, we have to occlude the external acoustic meatus. Okay. External acoustic. We have to occlude the external acoustic canal. So we are giving ourselves an conductive hearing loss. Okay. And then we have to compare. So we should strike the tuning fork, and we will be keeping it on mastoid of both the patient and the examiner. Okay. So the sound should be same. If the sound is in the absolute bone condition, if both the patient and the examiner are hearing for the same duration, it might be normal hearing or it might be conductive hearing loss. Okay. If the patient hears it for a short duration, then it might be sensorineural hearing loss. Okay. In absolute bone condition, we are occluding the tragus. Okay. The same test without occluding the tragus, it is called as Schwaback's test. So this topic of audiology is not so important in your theory perspective, but in the clinics, if a patient comes to you with hearing loss, in the OP you should diagnose which ear hearing and which ear is defective and what type of hearing loss. Okay, so that's why this is so important, and just to check the vestibular cochlear nerve. So this is not so important in your theory perspective. They won't ask anything, but in the practical perspective and the clinical perspective, this OP test is very, 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 very important and very significant. So kindly pay attention, and immediately after the class, you just go and read the book. Okay. So Schwaback's test, we don't occlude the tragus. So I understand this audiology will be a little bit dry, but no other way. I will be just dealing with very important topics. I'm not going very deeper into the every test, just very basic things that you should know when you pass this third year, and when you start practicing, what are the basic tests you should know. Only that test I'll be dealing. Okay. So Schwaback's, we don't give ourselves the conductive hearing loss. The tragus will be opened, and we are checking it with the examiner. Okay, so same as examiner, it will be normal. Okay, if it is shortened, it will be sensorineural hearing loss. What if it is lengthened? If the patient says I can hear it for a longer duration, okay, if it doesn't mean that patient says better than the doctors here. The very first step, the prerequisite is the examiner's hearing should be normal. So if the patient is hearing it for the longer duration, then it will be conductive hearing loss. Okay, because the other sound does interfere. Okay, the external sound doesn't interfere, and the patient hears it for the longer time. Okay, so in the Schwaback's, if the patient says he has lengthened his hearing sound for a longer time, so it will be conductive hearing loss. So okay, so this is the tuning fork test and the interpretation. So Rinne's test, if the air conducts more than, so the Rinne's positive, it will be normal, and Weber, it should not be lateralized. Near bone conduction same as examiner, and Schwaback, it should be equal. So what will happen in conductive deafness? The bone conduction will be, so Rinne is negative, lateral is to same ear or the poorer ear, airborne conduction same as examiner, and Schwaback's, as I told, it will be lengthened. Okay, so in sensory deafness, yeah, the Rinne will be positive, air conduction will be more than bone conduction, lateral is to better ear, I told the mnemonic source. Okay, sensorineural deafness, opposite ear. So if he has the sensorineural deafness in right ear, Weber's will be lateral is to left ear, and ABC is reduced, and Schwaback is shortened. Okay. So this is the tuning fork test. So next we will come to audiogram. So pure tone audiogram is a subjective test. Okay, the patient's cooperation is needed. I hope you would have seen an ENT piece in your medical college hospitals. Any patient comes with we should go to pure tone audiogram after completing the tuning fork test so that we will have some basic idea. Okay, so before going to pure tone audiogram proper, we should know what will be the decibels of hearing loss in each defects in the ear. Okay, so what will happen if there is complete obstruction of VAC? How many decibels will be lost? Decibel to 30 decibels. Okay, when there is complete obstruction of the external auditory canal, if there is TM perforation, impairing membrane perforation, hearing loss is 10 decibel to 40 decibel. Why this wide range of hearing loss and impairing membrane perforation? Because the it depends on the site of the perforation, size of the perforation, okay, and whether there is ocular discontinuity or not. But coming to the perforation, it will lead to it depends on the site and size, okay. Because if the perforation, I told you, is the tympanic membrane, right tympanic membrane, okay. So if there is perforation this long, and if it is exposing both the ovary and downwind, okay. If it is exposed here, there will be malleus, incus, and stapes. So, if the perforation is exposing both the oval window and round window, the ear will go directly into the oval window and round window at the same time. Okay. So, as I told, there is a phenomenon called phase difference. So, if the ear reaches both the oval and the round window at the same time, the phase difference will be lost. So there will be maximum hearing loss of 40 decibels. Okay. And if there is TM perforation with ocular discontinuity, malleus, incus, and stapes, if any of the ocicles get eroded, or if there is a discontinuity in the ocicles, there will be 40 decibel hearing loss. So if the TM is intact with ocular discontinuity, there will be 60 decibel hearing loss. So this ocular discontinuity means it will be in many of the middle ear diseases. We will see it later. So there will be 60 decibel hearing loss. So why there is maximum hearing loss when the tympanic membrane is intact, but there is only 40 decibel in tympanic membrane perforation? Because if there is a perforation in any of the quadrant, either anterior, inferior, anterior superior, through the perforation, ear will go reach the round window, or also sometimes it may reach the ocicles. Okay. So if the tympanic membrane doesn't vibrate through the perforation, some amount of ear will reach the ossicles. And the ossicles, provided if the ossicles are in good condition, okay, if the ossicles are in good condition, the ear will go there through the perforation. But if the tympanic membrane is intact and there is ossicular discontinuity, no ear will, tympanic membrane will not conduct any sound. Only the ossicles will be deficient, or the ossicles will be damaged. Okay, so in that condition, there will be 60 decibel hearing loss. Okay. So I hope you understand this concept, that if the tympanic membrane is intact, no ear will go inside. The tympanic membrane will never conduct, and the ossicles cannot conduct the sound to the oval window. So the transduction does not take process. So in tympanic membrane intact, there will be 60 decibel hearing loss. Okay, 55 to 60. I'm sorry, 55 to 60. If there is complete foot plate fixation. There is complete foot plate fixation, that is an otosclerosis. There will be more than 60 decibel hearing loss. Okay. So this is the basic hearing loss in middle ear pathologies. So before going into audiogram, so this is the basic audiogram. You would have seen in your OP, CNT, OIS that a patient coming with this sheet and we don't know what is being in a pre-final ear, even in a house agency. We don't have any proper idea what is this audiogram, and we usually skip this, and we will ask the patient to go and see the chief or assistant. So after this class, I hope you won't do that. So we will see that. Okay. So in pure tone audiogram, this is a chart. Okay. So there is a separation for right ear and left ear, and what we are going to see in the pure tone audiogram is ear conduction unmasked. What is masking and what is unmasking? I will say you. Air conduction mask. Bone conduction unmasked. And bone conduction masked. So, okay. So masking means we will mask the other ear, so that two ears won't the other ear won't participate in hearing. The other ear will keep. If we are checking the right ear, the other ear will keep busy. So that won't participate in the. In the test, and we can purely check the single ear that we want to know the hearing loss. Okay, so that is masking. So there, in the pure tone audiogram, there will be a marking. Okay, for each, there will be just notations, or there won't be any alphabets. There will be just marks like this. Okay, so red, right ear usually marked with red color. Okay, marked with blue color. So in air conduction unmasked, what will be this? It will be a circle. If you are checking right ear, air conduction unmasked, it will be marked as a circle. Okay, or for round. Left ear, it will be a cross. Okay, so remember, it is round. Okay, so left ear cannot be right. So remember it like that. Just one, okay. Only one cross will be there. And in air conduction mask, there will be a triangle. In left ear, air conduction mask, so you can rearrange this into as a square. Okay, in bone conduction unmasked, so it is opening towards right side. Okay, you can remember it like that. It is opening towards right side. In left ear, for bone conduction unmasked, it will be the opposite. It is opening towards the left side. Okay, you could see it is opening towards the left side. So masking and unmasking. Okay, I'll come into this. Sorry for the interruption. So we will be checking air conduction and bone conduction in a separate way, that is by masking and unmasking. So what is masking now? So when we want to check a single ear, okay, if you are as I told already, if any one ear is exposed to a sound, there will be also a participation from the other ear. Okay, so ஒரு உங்களுக்கே தெரியும், ஒரு சவுண்ட் வந்து நீங்க உங்க காதுக்கு முன்னாடி வச்சீங்கன்னா எந்த எந்த காதுல அதிகமா கேக்குதுன்னு தெரியும், ஆனா ரெண்டு காதுமே participate one. So to avoid that, so to avoid the participation of the other ear, we will be masking the other ear, or we will be keeping busy the other ear with any sound or music, whatever, so that we can check purely the one ear that we want to check. So that is masking and unmasking. Okay, so it will be done in both ear conduction and bone conduction. So in this is an, a type of audio, this is an audiogram chart. In this graph, we will be there won't be any alphabetics, whether it is air conduction or bone conduction. There is only marks. Okay, so red ear is for right, it is usually marked in red color, and for left it is in blue color. Okay, so remember this, or for our right for red, and the air conduction unmasking, it will be as round. Okay, so this here it is black. Sometimes if the chart is being taken a xerox or printed out, or if it is in your NEET exam, they are displaying it in a computer without the color xerox, it will be appearing entirely black. Okay, so at that time you cannot differentiate. So this is that type of graph. There is no such differentiation. But the basic is right ear will be in red color. Okay, left ear will be in blue color. So air conditioner unmasking will be the mark will be a circle. In left ear, the air conditioner unmasking will be a cross product, or you say it is wrong or into whatever it is. So in right ear, air conditioner masking, it will be a triangle. Left ear, a square. Okay, just rearrange the cross so that you will get a square. You remember it like that. And bone condition unmasking in right ear. So this thing is opening towards the left side. Okay, so it remember like the opening towards the right side. So you remember like that. Okay, this is red color. Okay. And the same in left ear, bone conduction unmasking, it is opening
So
towards
voice
the right,
break is report
left.
last
This is opening
one
towards the
minute.
right, this is opening towards the left. So bone conduction masked. So again, I will explain this right ear and left ear. Okay. So the right ear, the entire thing will be marked in red color. Left ear, it will be in blue color. Okay. So we are checking air conduction masked and unmasked, and bone conduction masked and unmasked for both the ears. Okay. So if it is right, it will be in red color. So first, you will see the right ear. Everything will be in red. If we are checking air conduction unmasked, it will be marked as a circle, just a circle. If we are checking air conduction masked, it will be a triangle. If we are checking bone conduction unmasked, it will be this thing. So that is a bracket will be opening towards the right. Okay. So if we are checking bone conduction masked, it is this bracket that will be also opening towards the right. If you are checking the left ear, everything will be in blue color. So air conduction unmasking. So if you are checking the air conduction unmasking left ear, it will be mentioned as just an into or a cross product. If you are checking the air conduction mask, it will be a square. If we are checking bone conduction unmasked, the same thing, the same bracket, but it will be facing towards the left or opening towards the left. And the same way in bone conduction unmasked, it will be opening towards the left. Okay, so I think it will be, if you are seeing this repeatedly for two or three times, I hope you could remember. Okay. So in air conduction, already told, in air conduction we are checking conductive plus sensory plus neural pathway. In bone conduction we are checking sensory plus neural pathway. Okay. So there is, in the Purton audiogram, there is also another thing called airborne gap or AB gap. So before that, how we should check this Purton audiogram? Okay, so this is the chart. So this is the decibels, the hearing, normal hearing, 0 decibel, 10 decibel, 20 decibel, and these are the frequencies. Okay, so the normal speech frequencies, as I already told, 500 hertz, 1000. So we'll be checking in all, but if we checked in this three, 500, 1000, so 500, 1000, 1000, so this three, it is enough. Okay, it is more than enough because this is the speech frequencies. Okay, so in 0 decibel, he is hearing. So there are two classifications we will be seeing later. So 0 to 25 decibels hearing loss is normal for everyone. Okay, 0 to 25 decibel hearing loss is normal. So till this 25, there is, it won't be that much significant, clinically significant. Okay, he may hear here. So in 0 decibel, here is hearing loss. So this depicts he cannot hear. So but within this 25, if it falls within this 25, it is normal. Okay, so after that, where he is hearing, this is the marking at which decibel, at which frequency he is hearing. Okay, so in 40 decibels, he is hearing in 500 hertz frequencies. So yes, this is considered as abnormal. Okay. Before that, I will give you that classification so that you could, it would be a little bit easier for you. So there is two classifications: American Speech for Hearing Association, OSHA classification. Okay. American Speech and Hearing Association. This is most commonly followed. This is for the decibels and the hearing loss. Okay. So if there is 0 to 25 decibel, it is considered normal. And more than 90 decibel, it is profound hearing loss. Okay, so in between, how we are going to fill? So there is mild, moderate, moderately severe, severe. So this, there is a many classification in this American Speech and Hearing Association. It is classified into normal, mild, moderate, moderately severe, severe, and profound. So 0 to 25, it is normal. More than 90 decibel, it is profound. So we have to split the remaining numbers. So that is 26 to 90 into these four categories. So we have to split it by 15. Okay. So 26 to 40 decibel, it is mild. So 41 to 55, it is moderate. Okay. So 56 to 70, moderate is severe. So last around 20. So 70 to 90 decibel is severe. Okay, so this is American Speech and Hearing Association's classification. So this is most usually followed. In NEET, coming to the NEET PG, there is also another classification. They will ask like this, WHO. In clinics, we are following this. Okay, so if in your pre-finals, if the examiner asks, he will be asking only this. If he specifically asks what is the WHO classification, then you should know. So the WHO classification is a little bit easier because one thing won't come. So moderately severe will not be there, okay? So normal, mild, moderate, severe and profound. So 0 to 25, same thing. 0 to 25 will be normal. More than 81 will be profound. Okay, here more than 90 will be profound. Here more than 81 will be profound. So the same 26 to 40, then 20 each in each classification. 41 to 60, 60 to 80. Okay, so you need not muck it up. 0 to 25 falls in normal for both classifications. In American Speech and Hearing Association, more than 90 decibel will be profound. Here more than 81. So mild, moderate, moderate, severe, severe. It comes under OSHA. In WHO, only mild, moderate, severe, and profound. So with this, we are classifying the hearing loss through the pure tone audiogram, and we are diagnosing what is the frequency he is not hearing. Okay. So as I told, this 500, 1000, and 2000 falls in speech frequency, and we are more keen on that. And 0 to 25, it will be normal. So if anything marked less than, or if anything marked below 25 or 30 decibels in the speech frequencies, we are worried about that. Okay, so that marks the degree of hearing loss. So in audiogram, what we are going to see is, what is the nature of hearing loss? From pure tone audiogram, what is the inference we are going to get is the degree of hearing loss. Degree of hearing loss, right or left ear. Okay, and what is the type of hearing loss? Conductive or sensory? Okay, in conductive hearing loss, there will be airborne gap. Okay, so see, air conduction and bone conduction, there will be gap. You could see here, this is bone conduction. Okay, bone conduction of the right ear, and this is air conduction of the right ear. So we are checking the same ear, but you could see the gap here, more than 15 decibel. Okay, so if the air bone conduction gap is there, which is more than 15 decibel, it will be conductive hearing loss. Okay, in sensorineural hearing loss, the airborne gap will be less than 15 decibel. So this is the main differentiation whether it is conductive hearing loss or sensorineural hearing loss. Okay. So when you are given an audiogram, what you should, how you should diagnose? First, you should know which ear it is, which ear we are checking. Okay. By the color or by the marks like this. Okay. So next, whether it is normal or abnormal. So here it is not normal because the hearing here's hearing loss not in this range. Okay, everything is here. Okay, so whether it is normal or abnormal. And third, we should see the airborne gap. If it is more than 15 decibel or less than 15 decibel, then and in sensorineural hearing loss there are two types. Okay, there is upsloping or downsloping. So this is not. See, if you want, we can go deeper into that. But that doesn't. You people won't need that much of knowledge into the audiogram. If you want, you can go and read it around. Okay. So if it is upsloping, it is Meniere's disease. Just you should know the name, the examples. That's all. If it is downsloping, it will be seen in presbyacusis. Presbyacusis is in the age-related hearing loss, noise-induced hearing loss, and ototoxicity. Okay. So these are high-frequency hearing losses. This meniesis, as I told, meniesis is low frequency. Okay. Low frequency hearing loss. It will affect the apex of cochlea. High frequency means basal tone of cochlea. Okay. So, and another two examples, noise-induced hearing loss. In noise-induced hearing loss, there will be dip at 4000 hertz. Okay, the audiogram will be given like that. So, you could see this is the 4000 hertz. There will be a dip like this. Okay. So, that is a characteristic of noise-induced hearing loss. In otosclerosis, there will be a dip at 2000 hertz, which is called as Cahort's notch. Okay. Cahort's notch. So only Cahort's notch doesn't mean it is otosclerosis. Okay. So there should be conductive hearing loss and there should be airborne gap. So, otosclerosis is a conductive hearing loss. We will see what is otosclerosis when we are seeing the pathology of the ear. Okay. So, I hope you understood what is Peutz audiogram and the basics of Peutz audiogram. Okay. So, next is impedance audiometry. So, I told you impedance is a function of middle ear. So we have to why when this impedance audiometry is done, because in situations where the tympanic membrane is intact but there is some pathology in middle ear. Okay, so middle ear with intact TM, intact tympanic membrane, we will be doing impedance audiometry. It includes two tests, that is tympanometry. Tympanometry is short notes for pre-finals. Okay, so kindly pay attention. It may be asked, it has been asked in previous years. Tympanometry and other one is stapedial reflex. Stapedial reflex, I have already told you. It is used for malingering. It is a protective reflex. The front is vestibular cochlea and the front is facial nerve. I have already told stapedial reflex when we are dealing with middle ear. Okay. So I won't go with this, go into stapedial reflex again. So tympanometry. So this is tympanometry. What we are checking is we are putting three probes into the external auditory canal. Okay. So one probe is for giving sound. The one probe will deliver sound into the ear. The next probe will pick up the sound that gets reflected. And the next third probe will give the pressure change in the external auditory canal. So through this, what we are going to see is to check the mobility of tympanic membrane. Okay. So the prerequisite of the test of this test is the tympanic membrane should be intact. After that only, if the tympanic membrane is intact only, we'll be doing this test. So to check the mobility of tympanic membrane. Okay. So what are all could be the inferences? What are all could be the possibilities? Okay. If the tympanic membrane moves excessively. Okay, if the tympanic membrane moves excessively, what is their medial to tympanic membrane? Ossicles. Okay, if the ossicles are not in continuation, or if there is ossicular discontinuity, so just imagine the tympanic membrane will move just like a paper. Okay, there won't be any support through the ossicles. So if the tympanic membrane moves excessively, there will be ossicular discontinuity. If the tympanic membrane moves less, there may be two scenarios. One is ossicular fixation. So if the ossicles are fixed, okay, and it is not moving to any sound, any sound is not conducted, as in orthosclerosis, the ossicles will be fixed. You can see the tympanic membrane will be taut. Okay, so the tympanic membrane will never move. And in another thing, there will be fluid in middle ear. So this will be the common inferences that we are going to get through this tympanometry. Okay, so and we are measuring complaints and middle ear pressure. Complaints is nothing but the ease with which tympanic membrane moves. Okay, if there is less resistance. So if there is less resistance means the ossicles are not in continuity. So the ossicles will never provide a resistance. So in that cases, there will be increased mobility, as I told. And next, what we are going to see is middle ear pressure. Middle ear pressure to check eustachian tube function. Okay, I told the eustachian tube will open in the anterior wall of the middle ear. The function of the eustachian tube is to ventilate the middle. Okay, so if the eustachian tube is blocked, the middle ear will not be ventilated, and it will lead to conductive hearing loss. So this is the tympanometry graph. You can see this is the complaints, okay, and this is the pressure. Middle ear pressure. Okay, so 100 to 100. So this is the normal pressure. So you can see all the graphs falling in it. Okay, so the complaints is higher. We'll start with that. The complaints is higher in AD type of graph. Okay, so what does that mean? If the complaints is higher, there is increased mobility. Okay, so there is ossicular discontinuity. So D for D. AD type of graph is seen in ossicular discontinuity. So you could see the next graph, A. So A is the complaints is normal and the middle ear pressure is also normal. So both is normal. So A is for normal. Normal ear. Okay, so there is no pathology. Next, we are going to see is AS. You could see the complaints is decreased. I told you what is the pathology if the complaints is decreased. So the tympanic membrane mobility is restricted. Okay, so what if there is tympanic membrane mobility restricted? That condition is called as ossicular fixation. Okay, so you could see there is another curve B, this one. Okay, in B you could see the middle ear pressure is also less and the complaints is also less. So B, if the middle ear pressure is less, there is some problem in eustachian tube. So the tympanic membrane will be intact. Okay, so CSO will never come into picture. So that will be serous otitis media, just fluid in middle ear. Okay, so this four and C. Okay, C is you could see the C, the compliance is normal, but the pressure is less. So this is early stage of eustachian tube obstruction. Early stage of eustachian tube obstruction. Okay, so this is a tympanometry graph. Everyone should remember this. Okay, so D for D. A means auscular discontinuity, S for auscular fixation, or you can remember as S for sclerosis, autosclerosis. Okay, so B you should remember serous otitis media, and C early stage of eustachian tube obstruction. Okay, so in auscular fixation, the complaints. The compliance is less and the middle pressure is normal. Okay, so in auscular discontinuity, so auscular fixation AS type of graph. Okay, auscular discontinuity CAD type of graph. In auscular discontinuity, the compliance is higher and the middle ear pressure is normal. Okay. So then B type of graph, that is fluid, fluid in middle ear, both the compliance is also reduced and the middle ear pressure is also reduced, and A type of graph is normal. Okay, both are normal. So this is the tympanometry that you should never forget. Okay, so next is recruitment. So what is recruitment? You no need to know in much detail, but you should know what is recruitment. Okay. So recruitment means there is abnormal growth or increase in loudness. Abnormal growth or abnormal increase in okay. So you could see that in this is left ear, this is right ear. The patient or a subject is hearing a sound in 0 decibel in left ear, but he is hearing the same sound in 30 decibels in right ear. Okay, so in 20 he is hearing in 40. If there is 35, he is hearing in 50. So in 80 decibels he is hearing in 80 decibels. So when the sound is very loud. Okay, so when there is increase in loudness, he is hearing it properly. So this property is called recruitment. Okay, so there is abnormal growth or abnormal increase in loudness of loud sounds. So this is seen in cochlear deafness, also called Meniere's disease. Recruitment is one of the property. Okay, so then another test is short increment sensitivity index, SASI. So this is, in this the patient is able to identify even a 1 decibel increased. Okay, so if he is checking as the patient will be sitting in the next room, there will be a window in front of him, a glass window will be in front of him, so he will be asked to raise the hand if he could appreciate the increase in sound. So the patient will be able to appreciate even 1 decibel increment. Okay, 1 decibel increment also he will be able to differentiate. So this prop, if the patient is able to identify like this in more than 70 to 100%, okay. So if the patient is delivered 20 decibel increment, okay, if he is able to identify all the 20 decibel, it will be 100%. If he is able to identify 15 to 17, so then it will fall between 70 to 100%. So if the patient successfully identifies 70 to 100% increment, so this is also a feature of cochlear deafness. Okay, so this is not normal. This is, don't consider this as a superpower. Okay, so this is not normal. This is always abnormal. If a patient could appreciate this, so he should be evaluated for. Okay, so next is autoacoustic emission. So this is the most important autoacoustic emission. Next you will be seeing Bera. So with that you will be completing the audiology part. So autoacoustic emission and Bera both are
important. Okay, for your exams, both OAE and BERA can be asked as short notes. And for coming to PG perspective, many MCQs should be asked from this OAE. So already I told, OAE is a measure of sound produced from outer hassles. Okay, O for O, I told you on that day. Okay, so outer hassles. So outer hassles are more in number, and they are more prone for damage. So by auto, this is the process of, or this is the test of autoacoustic emission. You could see a baby sleeping. Okay, so this is a screening test. Autoacoustic emission is a screening test. It is screening means it is done in a large number of population. Okay, it is done in large number of population. Any baby or any child which is born preterm, or is there any complications during delivery, we can use this test as a screening for the baby's hearing. Okay. So it is done to differentiate. Before that, it is done as a screening. It is done to differentiate cochlear and retrocochlear hearing loss and retrocochlear. Retrocochlear means the neural pathway. It also used to monitor ototoxicity. Because outer hassles, okay, ototoxicity, early noise induced hearing loss, everything can be obtained through this test. Okay, so this is the process. So in OAE, there are two steps. Okay, spontaneous. Two steps are two types: spontaneous and evoked. Spontaneous OAE and evoked. So what we are doing is evoked. So spontaneous is not done today. This evoked OAE is we test in our lab, in our audiometry room. Okay. So this evoked OAE, it's of two types: transient and distortion. Okay. So nothing to muck it up. It is very easy. So transient evoked autoacoustic emission means click sounds will be delivered to the baby or to anyone who is hearing. Okay. So this click sounds will be delivered in all frequencies, in all frequencies, mixing of all frequencies. Okay, so this transient evoked autoacoustic emission is used for screening in units. Okay, so next is distortion OAE. In this type is frequency specific, only a specific frequency is tested. Okay, so since this we are checking all frequencies, this is more important in screening. So this is, you should check only very specific frequency. It is used in ototoxicity. Okay, so if and in OAE I already told this is to differentiate cochlear and retrocochlear. So there is no part of conductive hearing loss. Okay, so if the conductive hearing loss, if there is conductive hearing loss and the conductive hearing loss is more than 30 decibel, the OAE test will be negative. It will be negative. Okay, so we are checking what the differentiate between sensory and cochlear or retrocochlear hearing loss. Okay, so the next is BERA. So BERA, so OAE is used to for screening. Okay, so this OAE cannot be done in ICU patients, cannot be done in ICU patients. Okay, ICU babies, but in neonatal ICU, pediatric ICU, this cannot be done. But this BERA can be done. So this BERA is always the best test to differentiate. But it is not easy. So I think you understand what is meant by screening. Screening means it is done on a large population. The test should be very cheaper. The test should be easily available. Okay, so that is called a screening. That is not a confirmatory test. Okay, so the confirmatory or the best test is BERA, brainstem evoked response audiometry. Evoked response audiometry. Okay, so this is also best to differentiate cochlear and retrocochlear hearing loss. This is best. Okay, So, in what are all the best can be what are the best tests we can do with this BERA? We can find the hearing loss in infants. Okay, that is a screening. This is confirmatory hearing loss in infants. This can be used for screen neonates in ICU. That cannot be done. Okay, this can be screened for screening neonates in ICU. Okay, and this is best audiologic test. Okay, best audiologic test for acoustic neuroma. Acoustic neuroma is vestibular schwannoma. Okay, so acoustic neuroma is vestibular schwannoma. It is also called cerebellopontine angle tumor. Okay, so best investigation will be always MRI. Any tumor of the skull or any tumor of the soft tissue, best investigation will be MRI. The best audiologic test will be acoustic neuroma. This is an MCQ perspective, and this can also be used for as a best test for malingering. Okay, malingering patient means non-organic hearing loss. There won't be any organic cause for that hearing loss, but the patient will be keep on saying, "I can't hear, I can't hear," to escape from any there will be any medico-legal causes also. So okay, so this test can be used also for malingering, differentiate the malingering. And in this brainstem-evoked response audiometry or BERA, there are sound waves. So what is that specialty of this BERA is, through the sound waves, it tells the site of the lesion. So we will be obtaining a graph, and there the graph will be of sound waves, and we will be able to know the where the lesion is, okay, in which site the lesion is. Okay, so one. But there's a subtypes also in this. Okay, so the fifth wave will be always present. Okay, so the first wave is from cochlear nerve. Cochlear nerve, the distal part of cochlear nerve. Second wave is also cochlear nerve, but from proximal part. Okay, so after the cochlear nerve, I hope you remember the auditory pathway. I told us SLIM. Okay, so third it will go to, sorry, third it will go to cochlear nuclei before going to superior olivary complex, cochlear nuclei, and then it will go into superior olivary complex, lateral lemniscus. It follows the same as auditory pathway. Okay, and inferior calculus. So these are the waves that we get through BERA. Okay, so if you are studying any neuromedicine also in your medicine postings, they'll be doing BERA. Okay, they'll also be doing BERA. So this is an important question, if even in your final years also. Okay, so what is BERA and what are the waves? It can be also in final year medicine also. So you should know what is BERA and what are the waves. And through this, we can know the site of lesion. Okay, so the fifth nerve, so the fifth wave, this is the largest or most prominent wave. So, being a prefrontal ear, this much is enough. Okay, so what are all the lesions, or what are all the lesions, whichever wave is appearing or disappearing, that is of a little bit higher standards. So they won't expect you to know that much. They'll expect you to know the basic waves and in which nerve they are taking part. Okay, so first wave from cochlear nerve, distal part. Second wave from cochlear nerve, proximal part. Then cochlear nuclei, then superior olivary complex, lateral lemniscus, and inferior calculus. Okay, so if there is latency between the first and third wave increases. Okay, latency between first and third wave increases, it will show you the site of lesion. So for site of lesion, the latency should increase. Okay, so in acoustic neuroma, which is a cerebellopontine angle, there will be increased lesion or increased latency between 1 and 5 waves. Okay, acoustic neuroma, there will be increased latency between 1 and 5. So coming to BERA, that is enough. உங்களுக்கு ரொம்ப
அச்சா
முக்கியமானது வந்து டியூனிங் ஃபோர்க் டெஸ்ட். நம்ம பார்த்தது ரெனி சுபஸ், உங்க பேசிக் கிளினிக்கல் நாலேஜ், பியூட்டோ நாலோகிராம், பேசிக் கிளினிக்கல் ப்ராக்டிஸ்ல, அண்ட் ஓஏ பெரா. நான் சொன்ன வரைக்கும் அண்ட் டிம்போனோமெட்ரி வந்து நம்ம பெருசா என்ன சொல்றது நம்ம ஓபில பாக்குறது இல்ல, பட் ஃபார் ஃபார் எக்ஸாம் பெர்ஸ்பெக்டிவ், தியரி எக்ஸாம் பெர்ஸ்பெக்டிவ்ல வந்து டிம்போனோமெட்ரி, ஓஏ பெரா ரொம்ப இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். கிளினிக்கல் பெர்ஸ்பெக்டிவ்ல டியூனிங் ஃபோர்க் டெஸ்ட் அண்ட் பியூட்டோ நாடோகிராம், இந்த மூணும் ரொம்ப இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். டியூனிங் ஃபோர்க் டெஸ்ட் தெரியாம எந்த எக்ஸாமுக்கும் போயிடாதீங்க, எந்த ப்ராக்டிக்கல் எக்ஸாம், இஎன்டி ப்ராக்டிக்கல் எக்ஸாம் இருந்தாலும் சரி, மெடிசன் ப்ராக்டிக்கல் எக்ஸாம் இருந்தாலும் சரி, டியூனிங் ஃபோர்க் டெஸ்ட் தெரியாமல் போகக்கூடாது. ஓகே, தியரி எக்ஸாமுக்கு இந்த மூணும் தெரியாமல் போகும். ஆடியாலஜி வந்து உங்களுக்கு கேள்வி கேட்கணும்னா இந்த நான் இவ்வளோ நேரம் சொன்னால இதுல இருந்து தான் கேட்பாங்க. இதை தாண்டி தேர்ட் இயருக்கும் சரி, நீட்டுக்குமே இதை தாண்டி பெருசாக கேட்க மாட்டாங்க. எம்சிக்யூ ஓரியன்டட்னாலுமே இதை தாண்டி பெருசாக ஆடியாலஜி வந்து கேட்க மாட்டாங்க. சரி, இஃப் இட் இஸ் அ நார்மல் கொஸ்டின், ரொம்ப டஃபாக கேட்கணும்னா என்னாலும் கேட்கலாம், பட் இட் வோன்ட் ஹேப்பன். ஓகே, ஸோ தேங்க்யூ ஃபார் டுடே செஷன் கைஸ், ஹோப் யூ அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட். கஷ்டமாக தான் இருக்கும் இது, ஐ ஹோப் ஐ நோ த டிஃபிகல்டிஸ் இன் தி டிஃபிகல்டி இன் திஸ் டாபிக். இதுக்கப்புறம் வென் வென் ஒயில் வி ஆர் என்டரிங் த கிளினிக்கல் பார்ட் ஆர் த பெத்தாலஜி டிசீசஸ்லாம் போகும்போது இட் வில் பி மச் மோர் இன்ட்ரெஸ்டிங், அண்ட் திஸ் திங்ஸ் வாட் வி ஹவ் சீன் சோ ஃபார் வில் ஹெல்ப், ஷுர்லி இட் வில் ஹெல்ப். ஓகே, இதெல்லாம் வேஸ்ட் கிடையாது. ஸோ டோன்ட் திங்க் வாட் இஸ் திஸ் இது என்ன இப்படி இருக்குன்ட்டு, டோன்ட் எவர் திங்க் லைக் தட், இட் வில் ஹெல்ப் யூ இன் த ஃபர்தர் கிளாஸஸ். ஓகே, ஸோ தேங்க்யூ கைஸ், தேங்க்யூ.